We are near Florence, South Carolina at the PD Research and Education Center, and I'm speaking with TJ Savereno. TJ, which one of the extension teams are you associated with?
I am on the Forestry and Wildlife Extension team.
Okay, and we are today going to talk about longleaf. There's a real interest in longleaf, and historically, how important was longleaf in our part of the world?
Well, longleaf was the dominant upland species in the coastal plain from Virginia, or parts of Virginia, down through our part of the world, and then on out into the Gulf Coast all the way to Texas. Mm-hmm. It was the dominant species in a lot of the upland habitat. And estimates are that it covered between 60 and 93 million acres.
Phew! Boy, what wildlife habitat that was.
Yes.
Yeah. And now we're down to?
Somewhere between 3 and 4 million. There's been a lot of restoration efforts going on, and we're picking up acreage each year.
Okay. And one of the fascinating things about longleaf is that it's fire dependent, and that when it had that massive area that it covered, that could have even been from natural lightning strikes and things, or I believe even indigenous people.
Yes.
And it's got all kind of adaptations that makes it able to withstand fires of a certain type.
Exactly, yeah. The Southeast is known for its lightning storms, right? Especially down in Florida, where it reaches its ultimate level of burning. So fires historically that were set by lightning would burn until they ran out of fuel or until they hit a body of water and couldn't burn any further. There wasn't anybody to put the fires out. So fire was a big part of the evolutionary history of that ecosystem. And the indigenous people did burn. They knew the beneficial effects of fire in creating habitat where they could hunt game more easily and control pests like ticks and things like that. So there was a lot of fire used by indigenous people as well. Longleaf is very fire tolerant. It's fire dependent. It's not fireproof. Mm-hmm. You can kill longleaf with fire at inappropriate times. But it is dependent on fire for controlling competition from other species. Every plant that grows here and any plant that's growing around a longleaf seedling is competing with it for resources like food, nutrients, water, sunlight. And if conditions aren't right for that seedling, it'll sit in what's called the grass stage, which is just a little tuft of needles mm-hmm. that come up out of the ground. And until that competition is removed by prescribed fire and sunlight is sufficient to support the growth of that plant, it will start to bolt in what we call the rocket stage, where it really starts putting on height growth.
And one of the things about longleaf is it looks like it when it's kind of cupped around the growing tips, and I think that helps protect that growing tip.
Yeah, those terminal needles surround the terminal bud, which is the growing point on that branch, and it's important that part not get killed by fire, and it can be killed by fire. But those surrounding needles, when they burn, they have moisture in them, and that moisture evaporates, and what it does is it reduces the temperature around that terminal bud and helps to protect it from that extreme heat.
And one of the wonderful things is we found that there's some endangered species that now that y'all have learned that prescribed fire is important and are using that, not only are we getting all this sunlight, so we've got pollinators supporting
yes.
herbaceous and woody, herbaceous perennial and annual plants coming up. But I think there's even a bird that's particularly dependent on this.
Yeah, the federally endangered red-cockaded woodpecker is dependent on an open understory. It forages on the bark of trees for things like ants. And if there is a lot of understory, hardwood understory that comes in the absence of fire, they will abandon that site. They can't move around easily, they become open to predation. The trees will grow up near the level of their cavity and allow predators to get in. And eventually, as those conditions deteriorate, the birds will abandon those sites.
And then here, you're doing some research because there are federal programs to encourage the replanting of longleaf pine. And you're looking at two stands of longleaf that had historically very different backgrounds, trying to decide how a grower should, how far he should go in trying to provide
right.
seeds, if necessary, for this pollinator species to come back in?
What we try to find out is, you know, what the legacy of their land use is and what their likelihood of success may be before they go to the expense of buying a lot of native seed, which can be expensive depending on what species are included in it. They may want to, if they're willing to give it some time and do some management practices like using prescribed fire, they may not need to go to that that time and expense.
Okay.
The area behind us here was is 12 acres. It was historically crop field. It was cropped as long as Clemson has owned this property, and it was cropped prior to that, at least decades, if not for 100 years plus. And the other area is 36 acres that was previously a longleaf pine stand. It was cut in 1996, and we were able to get these sites back into shape and plant longleaf in both of them because they represent very different starting points that that people may experience on their own land.
Because there's going to be a different seed bank in the soil.
Correct.
And what did you find, TJ?
Well, the site behind us, the 12 acres, the last crop that was planted in here was soybeans in 2008. And in 2009, which was the same year we planted the other site, we planted it in longleaf pine. We did not plant any of the native plants that you see in here right now.
Mm.
And in the first couple of years, we had problems with things like Texas panicum, sickle pod, and other things. Had to do a banded herbicide application over the seedlings in order to allow them to survive. But other than that, all that we have done here is manage it with prescribed fire. And we got species like broom sedge come in and the blue stem grasses, which are great for carrying fire through the stand, which is really important. But we've also got these native legumes that are showing up in here too, and goldenrod that you see in the background, and pitiopsis, and just a multitude of species. And over time, it gets better and better.
So those were deep within the seed bank, I guess.
They were, to some degree. Some of them were probably carried in by wildlife.
Yeah. So this now is good habitat.
It is. It's good habitat for a lot of different species. It's great pollinator habitat. And bobwhite quail, we hear them frequently in this stand.
So you've got some native coveys here that have established,
which is
really important and kind of unusual. And then the other place, which had been longleaf for Lord knows how many decades and decades and decades.
Right.
Let's talk about the experience you found over there.
Sure. Unfortunately, it was cut before I started here, so I don't know exactly what it looked like, but I'm told by other people who have worked here for years and years that there was some really nice big longleaf trees in there. It was cut in 1996, but there was no follow-up treatment done to it. So it grew up in some hardwood species and some loblolly pine as well. Things like persimmon and sassafras and other things like that, and some oak species as well, which kind of closed the canopy and there wasn't much sunlight able to get to the ground. So it was fairly barren in there, but once we removed all that vegetation, we had to do an aerial application of herbicide on that site to take out those taller trees, which we were talking about 20 to 30 feet tall, and then removed that through mulching and planted those seedlings, and the response has been amazing. The diversity there is so much greater than what you see here, even though this is getting really good. It doesn't compare to what was in that stand, which never was turned by a plow and was not farmed. And that seed bank, which is the few inches of soil below the surface that contain all those seeds that accumulate over time, was just sitting there waiting to respond.
Okay. Well, I think it's wonderful to see that Clemson's doing research that, first of all, joins in with the government programs that are encouraging the reestablishment of this and the wildlife that we've lost so much of their habitat, and this is restoring that. And then also seeing to it that the people who choose this route can do it in the most economical way.
Right, right. We don't want anybody to go broke doing this, and there's no reason for that.
That's because you're doing that good work here.
Yes, trying to. Yeah. Yes.
Well, we thank you for that.
Yep, thanks.